Hey, good morning, everybody. Oh, sweet. You guys sound like you're ready. Let's hope I am, huh? Hey, would you guys mind standing and singing with us real quick? Or for a little while, I guess?
Whatever you want.
I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves a 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, until you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. I was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves a 99. I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves a 99. I couldn't earn it, and
I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Hey, so, you know, I know I was up here a couple weeks ago, and I don't know everybody here. Like, you know, you guys probably don't know me either. So, hi, I'm Jonathan, and one thing I'll warn you about, some of you know how I've led worship in the past. It's probably been 2 years since I've actually led the whole thing. But I get pretty excited when I'm up here. You know, and it's not just because... I mean, I'll be honest, my dad was a DJ, and I grew up around music. I love music. But God is here today, and there is nothing better than that ever, 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 ever. Few more evers there. So, I'm going to apologize before we move into our next songs. Because I play a little faster. I play some different songs. You might not know them. You might know them. Most of my stuff's a little bit older because, like I said, I haven't been up here in a while. But, yeah, I just want you guys to know that God is here. Like, he is the reason for everything. And I'm so excited to share that with you guys today. Like, I can't even describe it. But I don't know, man. I'm just excited. I had other stuff I wanted to say, and I just... told you all that instead, so let's have fun. With this heart open wide, from the depths, from the heights, I will bring a sacrifice. With these hands lifted high, hear my song, hear my cry. I will bring a sacrifice. I will bring a sacrifice. My pride, giving up all my rights. Take this life and let it shine, shine, shine. Take this life and let it shine. I lay me down, I'm not my own. I belong to you alone. Lay me down, lay me down. Oh, hand on my heart, this much is true. There's no life apart from you. Lay me down, lay me down. Oh, lay me down, lay me down. Will be my joy to say, your will, your way. It will be my joy
joy to say, your will, your way, it will be my joy to say, your will, your way, always, it will be my joy to say, your will, your way, it will be my joy to say, your will, your way, it will be my joy to say, your will, your way, always. I lay me down, I'm not my own, I belong to you alone. Lay me down, lay me down. Is true, there's no life apart from you. Lay me down, lay me down. Oh, lay me down, lay me down. Oh, lay me down, lay me down.
All right, you guys can have a seat.
Well, good morning, everybody. I want to welcome you here. If you're joining us online, thank you for being here. If you're joining us in person, just getting back from spring break, I apologize about the weather. It's just the way it is. We have one service today, as you know. I wanted to let you know also that we're going to be having one service here, 10:30, for the rest of April, as we continue through the Lightbearer series that we're doing. Also a reminder, we have crash tonight at 5:30 for the youth students. Meet in the gym at 5:30. It is going to be happening. The reason that we're doing this Lightbearers series is Sam, as well as Doug right now, and Edward are traveling across Africa. They're doing a motorcycle mission, basically. They're doing different pastors' conferences and teachings. They've been in Kenya, Tanzania, I think the Congo, a couple other places recently. So continue praying for them. If you want to get updates, follow Hope 2 on Facebook. They post about it regularly there. Also continue to pray for the other light bearers, the people who are going to be preaching over the next coming months. It's a really special opportunity that we have here at Harvest to have people who are willing to do this, to step up and share messages that God has laid on their heart. This week we have Jerry, who's going to be preaching, Jerry Welter. This is not his first time preaching here at Harvest, but every time is a first time. It's a first time to share that message that God has given you. I'm excited to hear what he has to say today. Before we continue into worship, I wanted to kind of share with you a Bible verse that's been on my mind this past week. So as some of you know, when I preached last week, I mentioned I just got back from Uganda. So this has kind of been something that I've been wrestling with recently. This is Ephesians chapter 2. Here, Paul's writing this letter, and he's talking about salvation through Christ, and he's talking about how there's this opportunity for the Jews and the Gentiles, these two people groups who were diametrically opposed for most of their existence, to be reconciled together. And he makes this point, and he says here in 2:19, "Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is being joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit." And to me, I think what sticks out to me about that is the more I go to Liberia, to Uganda, wherever, it kind of makes me realize something about here as well, which is that no matter what's going on in the world, whether it's conflict with Russia and Ukraine, Middle East, poverty in Africa, or just stuff here at home, there is an encouragement that we can turn to, and that is that as brothers and sisters in Christ, it doesn't matter what nation we're from, it doesn't matter what background we're from, it doesn't matter where we've been in life or where we're going, we have one thing that we can count on, that through Christ, through this word, we are brothers and sisters. We are family members now. I mean, it's an amazing opportunity that we get to have to look at relationship like that. And that's why we say at Harvest, we're all about sharing life. This is what it means. I'm just really glad that you could be here today. I'm so excited that we get to hear what Jerry has to say. Will you guys pray with me, and then we'll get back into worship. God, I just want to thank you for the weather, for everything that you provide for us, things that we can't even understand at this time. I thank you that you've put messages into the hearts of the people here at Harvest and that we have a place where we can share those. I thank you that there are people here who have ears to hear these messages, and I have no idea what they're going to get out of them, but I know that it's all part of your plan. I know that we have a purpose, that you have a plan, God, and I just hope that you would allow us to carry that out, that you would give us strength. I thank you for everyone here who's willing to lead worship, to teach in the classrooms, to do their part. And I just pray that you would be with us today. In your name, amen.
Waking up to a new sunrise, looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes, darkest water and deepest pain, wouldn't trade it for anything, 'cause my brokenness brought me to you. And these wounds are a story you'll use. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the scars. Now I'm standing in confidence with the strength of your faithfulness, and I'm not who I was before. No, I don't have to anymore. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the scars. I can see how you delivered me. In your hands, in your feet, I found my victory. I can see how you delivered me. In your hands, in your feet, I found my victory. So I'm thankful for your scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And with my life I'll tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful. I am thankful for your scars, 'cause without them scars.
guys can have a seat.
Good morning. My name's Dave Kirby, for you that don't know me. My wife and I have been coming here since last September, and we're happy to be a part of the church family here. I want to start this morning. I was blessed in a lot of ways that I got to travel around the world. I left here, Muncie, at the age of 19 to find myself in the middle of Germany. On my 19th birthday, pretty lonely. Part of when you go to Germany as a soldier, part of what would happen is you would go through orientation where they'd orientate you to the country. Part of that orientation is they would take you to a different place. The place that I went to was a place called Dachau, Germany. For those of you who don't know, Dachau was home of one of the worst concentration camps in all of Germany. When we get there, I remember seeing the fence, I can still see it today, and seeing the gate. It's a memorial now. You go through the gate, and over the top of the gate, you have in English and in German, it says, "Never forget." And they put that there purposely, and it's also inside a wall, and a memorial inside the wall, inside the place, but they put there purposely to remind people not to forget what happened there. So that made me think this week about remembering that in our communion service. One of the fears that I have is that we, as Christians and as believers, that we forget why we do this sometimes. And I think sometimes we come, we go, well, this is the part where we take communion, we eat the cracker, drink the juice, and we go on. But it's important that we remember it's something much, much deeper than that. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starting in verse 23, "For I received from the Lord that which also delivered to you, the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he betrayed, took the bread. And he had given thanks, he broke it and said this, 'Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" See, Jesus is telling us, never forget. Never forget why we take communion every week. Never forget that he died on the cross for our sins. And I think that's important for us to remember. I don't want communion just to become another part of the service. This is very special to all of us. Let us pray. Father God, I'd like to thank you for this time that we share with you, that we can proclaim that you died on the cross for us so we could have eternal life. All we have to do is take one step in accepting you into our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen.
Would you guys stand and sing with us, please? My heart, Lord, here's my heart, Lord, here's my heart, Lord, speak what is true, here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true, 'cause I am found. I am yours. I am loved. I'm made pure. I have life, I can breathe, I am healed, I am free. Here's my heart, Lord, here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true, 'cause I am found. I am yours. I am loved. I'm made pure. I have life. I can breathe. I am healed, I am free. You are strong, you are sure. You are life, you endure. You are good, always true. You are light, breaking through. Can breathe. I am healed. I am free. 'Cause you are strong. You are sure. You are life. You endure. You are good. Always true. You are light. Breaking through. You guys can have a seat. Kids, you're dismissed.
Thank you, Jonathan. Great job. All of you, appreciate it. Good morning.
Morning.
Welcome to Harvest. And for those of you watching online or wherever this message finds you, good morning. My name is Jerry Welter, and as Drew said, I'm one of the light bearers here, so I'll be giving you the message this morning. And he is right, this isn't my first time up here. And I say that because this will be the fifth time that I've preached this message in the last 2 weeks. I got to say that because there's something I got to make sure I'm right here in front of my wife, too, because I want to make sure she hears this when I say this. So the first time I preached this message, and it's on the gravity of grace. Now, I've been doing a lot of my speaking here lately in a correctional setting. And because there's so many inmates, and that's a good thing, that want to come to the services, we have to spread them out over like 4 services a week. I mean, there's several hundreds and hundreds of inmates that come to these things. So the first time I did this message, at the very end of it, a gentleman comes up to me, and how many of you ever heard of Louis Giglio? Anybody? Okay, so I've got these, just a couple of these slides up here, and he comes up to me at the end of the service, and he says, hey, do you have any YouTube videos? Because see, here's the thing, in corrections, they have these tablets, and they can watch videos and movies, you know, within the DOC's discretion. I know, right, it's crazy over here. Prisons here are nothing like they are in Liberia, Africa. We have flat screens in here. I mean, it's just crazy. So anyway, that's where your tax dollars are going, by the way. Nope. Hopefully I won't get digged for that. But anyways, so he comes up and he says, hey, you have any videos? And I'm trying to think, okay, so I preach sometimes at different churches and they usually have Facebook or YouTube. And I'm trying to scramble my brain. I'm like, no, I don't really. I don't make videos. And then he starts talking about planets and stars. And I realized he was talking about Louis Giglio. He thought I was Louis Giglio. I'm like, oh my gosh. But wait, now wait for it. Fast forward to the next week, same message, get to the end of it, another inmate comes up, and he starts asking me if I've heard of Louis Giglio and if I've seen any of Louis's videos, and I need to tell the guys that where they can find Louis on the tablet so they can watch Louis Giglio. So I went from being like Louis to, hey, you need to watch Louis. So if you want to deflate a preacher or a pastor, just tell him he needs to go watch somebody else's message. So hopefully we won't have that experience here this morning. So how many of you came here this morning because maybe you're feeling heavy or you got a, I don't know what you're bearing today, but does anybody kind of need something uplifting, rejuvenated, maybe your spirit set back up or battling some anxiety, any of that going on? Any of those? We got a few of those. I see a few hands, some in the back. All right, good. Then this message is for you. It's really for all of us. So I'm just excited about what God's going to do in here. So before we get started, we're going to pray. And one thing I like to do before I start my message is just kind of prep our hearts to encounter a holy God. I love what Jonathan had to say up here. So a lot of times people, they come to services and they got their phone and they're surfing their social media and they're playing video games. If they're way in the back, you get to watch them because they're probably... But anyway, so that's really not the way we want to position ourselves if we really want to receive from God. God is so great. He is so awesome. And He is so worthy, right, of our worship that we want to come a little bit reverently. Yes, Jesus opened the door and yes, Jesus made a way, but we should come reverently because He is still a holy, awesome, and great God. And if we could just posture ourselves as we come into His presence this morning before we pray. Are you with me? Yes. Amen. All right, so let's pray. So, Father, thank You for the message. Thank You for what Jonathan was sharing with us. You are here. And we just pray that You would come in power, that You would anoint the message, that You would touch us to the very core of our needs, to where we are liberated, and we walk out of here a lot lighter than the way we came in. And it is in Jesus' name we pray. And everyone says, amen. Amen. All right. So, what we're going to do here is we're going to start this message kind of like some movies start, where they take a scene that's going to appear later in the movie and they put it at the very beginning of the movie and they play that scene and they catch up to it and then they start at the beginning of the movie and then they catch up to the scene later on in the movie. They kind of build the anticipation that way. I've preached this 5 times, so I got to do something to make it exciting for me, okay? So I'm going to take a section of the text. I'm going to put it at the beginning of the sermon. We'll catch up to it, and then we'll start, and we'll catch up to that part of the text later on, kind of build the anticipation a little bit. So, in light of the message, the gravity of grace, imagine you're on vacation. You've flown to wherever, let's say Florida. You get there, either you drove or you have to get a rental car. All right, and you're staying in a hotel, so you pull into the parking lot. You get out of the car, you unpack your kids. Sometimes vacation's like work if you have kids. So you unpack your kids, your luggage, you head to the hotel. All right. Now you're going to be on, let's say, the seventh floor. So you get to the elevators, you hit the button, the door opens, you go fumbling in, your family, your luggage, you're all in there. You hit the button, the door shuts, and stop. We're going to pick back up on that scene in just a minute. So now, let's go to the beginning. The gravity of grace. Now, the gravity of grace. You know, gravity has this way of kind of weighing you down, pulling you down, but the gravity of grace works just the opposite. It actually lifts and pulls you up. And that may sound like an oxymoron, but that's just the way the gravity of grace works. You know, while the world pulls you down in the mundane, you know, with the gravity of grace, you're up there like Louis Giglio. So, this message originally was just titled Gravity, and I was just going to talk about how the world kind of pulls at us and how we have to combat that. But the more I got into the message, the more I realized this is really about the gravity of the grace of God. And I want you to kind of see how that evolved, kind of how that transformed. So I'm just going to take a minute and talk about gravity. You know, gravity is this natural phenomenon. It's an unseen force where all things with energy, mass, planets, stars, even light, all these things are attracted and gravitate toward one another. Similarly, there are things in the world that work just like gravity. They attract us by appealing to the desires of our flesh, right? Our fallen nature, our carnal desires, even our egos sometimes. And we feel it. We can feel the pull of the world to conform to its ways. We feel the pull in the political parties and their agenda. We feel the pull for lust and for power and to appear important. We're always feeling the pull. And just like gravity, this attraction is governed by an unseen force. Listen to what Paul says in Ephesians 6. He says, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." So there is this unseen force at work. So it's not your spouse, it's not your boss, it's not your coworkers, it's not an addiction or a disease, it's not your circumstances. We're dealing with a real devil assisted with about a billion fallen angels. This is our battle. Here comes the good news. Here's the thing about gravity. The bigger the object, the stronger the pull. That's the way it works. And this is where my perspective began to change, because the further I went into the subject material in this sermon, the more I realized how great and how great God is and how great the grace of God is. And with that said, we're going to take a minute and we're going to look at this picture right here behind us. And before we do, I want to say something. I love the way the Message translation does Isaiah 54:2. He writes, "Clear lots of ground for your tents. Make your tents large. Spread out. Think big." So he's challenging us to think big about God, to stretch our imaginations about how awesome, how mighty, how eternal, how infinite, how able our God is. To try and conceptualize that really goes beyond human abilities. But this might give us a little bit of a look. So we're looking here at, this is the M51 galaxy. It's also known as the Whirlpool galaxy. It's about 31 million light years away. That got nothing. In space, and I love the way Louis Giglio talks about that, the tape measure, the yardstick does you no good. We have to use a light year to navigate our way around. And really, that's not even adequate for the vastness of the universe. But a light year is how far light travels in a year. Light travels at 186,000 miles per second. That means you could circle the Earth 7.5 times in 1 second going at that speed. But the distance it travels in 1 year is 5.88 trillion miles away. Take that times 31 million, and that's where the Whirlpool galaxy is, with a span of about 60,000 light years from end to end. And when I think about these things, it just blows my mind about how great our God is. Now, when you think about the stars and we look out in the night sky, they don't look that far apart from here, but usually, on average, each star is about 30 trillion miles apart. And there are billions of them in this Milky Way galaxy alone. Show that next slide. Now, you may be thinking that you're looking at this conglomerate of stars, but really what you're looking at is this cluster of galaxies. It's crazy. There's quite possibly billions of these 60 and 100,000 light year distant galaxies in our universe. You're starting to kind of get the picture of how big and how able God is. This is the God we serve. Listen, Psalm 33 says, "The Lord merely spoke and the heavens were created. He breathed the word and all the stars were born." I love this because the Hebrew here wants to, when they use the word breath, they're trying to describe how God actually exhales stars effortlessly. And there are billions of this thing. God just exhales and you get that. That should build confidence. I remember one time I was going through my Bible, and sometimes you can open your Bible and you're needing a word, you turn right to it, right? That ever happened to anybody? It's like, yeah, I needed that, right? And then the longer you walk with God, the further and far between that seems to happen. But I was desperate. I needed a word. I opened up my Bible, I turned right to this psalm, and I had a little post-it note in there. And this is what it said. It said, "Don't tell God how big your problems are. Tell your problems how big your God is." I love that. Don't tell God how big your problems are. Tell God, or tell your problems how big your God is. Here's something interesting in math. Infinity. Whenever you take a number and you divide it by infinity, it's always zero. If it's, even if it's 1 billion trillion divided by infinity, it's zero. So in other words, we serve an infinite God. When we take our problems and we size them up next to God, they are nothing compared to God. I got nothing. When you take, let me try this over here. When you take your problems and you put them next to an infinite God, they are nothing. Amen. God's got it. Speak to your giants. I love what David did when he was in the valley facing that giant. He said, "You come at me with all this stuff, and I'm coming at you in the name of God Almighty." When the devil starts asking, "Where's your God?" tell him he's in the same place he's always been, sitting on the throne, reigning as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and he's got this. Amen. Here's another thing. God says, Jeremiah 32:27, he says, "I am the Lord, the God of all mankind. Is anything too hard for me?" And really, there's another power behind gravity, because the Bible says in Colossians that he, Jesus, holds all things in his hands. And that includes your life. You're in good hands. Allstate has nothing on Jesus. All right. Got to turn the page here. It's not that I have a big stack. I always scare people with these notes. But really what it is, I have to blow the font up about that big so I can see them. So the Message translation in Ephesians 3:20 says, "God can do anything you know, far more than you could ever imagine or guess or request in your wildest dreams." I just love that. So getting back to gravity, if you're a parent, you know this battle against the pull of peer pressure. We now have grandchildren, and it's a constant battle. But this verse came to my mind when I was thinking about that and how we have to battle that. And it's in Proverbs. It says, "Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." Now, when I was thinking about that verse, something else came to my mind. Sea turtles. It's amazing. Little sea turtles. Anybody ever seen sea turtles hatch on the beach? It is the coolest little thing. These little guys hatch, they go out, they hit the ocean, and then they go out for thousands of miles. And when the females are ready to come back and lay their eggs, they have this ability, this uncanny ability, to come back to right where they left and lay their eggs. That is crazy. And scientists are trying to figure out how they do that, and what they think is that there's this magnetic impression that's put on them while they're in their eggs on the beach, and they can find that magnetic impression when they're coming back to lay their eggs. And then it hit me why the Lord had put that on my heart. He was telling me that, hey, look, no matter how far out your kids go, that magnetic impression of the gospel will always bring them back. Show this next slide here. Next slide. It's a pretty important slide. Maybe it's a good time to take a drink of water. There it is. What's that look like to you? Mm-hmm. That is the center of the Whirlpool Galaxy. That is far out as the Hubble could reach. Credit to Louis Giglio for pointing that out. that it could reach, and it shot the center of the Whirlpool galaxy, 31 million light years away, and that's what it sent back. That's God's way of saying, no matter how far out you go, my grace is always there for you when you get there. I love that. Psalm 139:8 says, if I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. His grace is always there for his children, no matter where you are. Now, getting back to the gravitational pull of the flesh. It's referred to in the Bible as the law of sin and death. Don't go to sleep on me here, okay? It works the same way that the law of gravity does. And this is how the law worked against us. And the law here I'm talking about are the laws given in the Old Testament. There's like 630-something prohibitions. You've got the Ten Commandments. In fact, you're going to be amazed at how fast I can read all of these to you real quick. So if you have your Bibles, you want to turn with me to, and I'm just kidding, right? I did this in one service, and I heard this guy go, amen. I go, we're going to pray for you when it's over. Can you feel the weight of that, though? You know, like, man, to sit there under and have someone read all those. It's like a long, boring, have you ever had a long, boring sermon where like, this is just going to go on forever? Hopefully you're not encountering that right now. But it's just like, this is terrible. You can just feel the weight of that. That's what the law did. Listen to what Paul writes in Romans 7. Oh, and here's one thing I need to point out. The more the law was presented, the more we focused on it, the stronger the pull, the stronger the effect the law had. Now listen to what Paul says in Romans 7. You don't have to turn anywhere. He says, what shall we say then? Is the law sinful? Certainly not. Nevertheless, I would not have known what sin was had it not been for the law. For I would not have known what coveting was if the law had not said, don't covet. But sin, seizing the opportunity afforded by the commandment, thank you, produced in me every kind of coveting there was. So for apart from the law, sin was dead. So what he's saying is the more I focused on it, the stronger the pull. Let me ask you something. Have you ever tried to stop doing something and you just find yourself doing more of it? I used to be a smoker, and so when I tried to quit, I went from one pack a day to two packs a day. I don't know how that happened. Have you ever tried to quit eating? It's like, hey, we're going to go out to dinner and have a big meal because tomorrow I'm going on a diet. We're going to do more before we do less. I don't understand. What's wrong with us? Like, we're going to do less, so we need to do more. It's like, what? What's up? The more you try to change, the more opposition you experience because your focus is on the thing you're trying to get free from. And the more you focus on it, the bigger it gets. Now, I got to read this out of the Message Bible, this chapter 7 in Romans. Because this is poetry right here. He says, Paul writes, he goes, I can anticipate the response that is coming. I know all the commands are spiritual, but I'm not. Isn't this also your experience? Yes, I'm full of myself. After all, I've spent a long time in sin's prison. What I don't understand about myself is that I decide one way, but then I act another. Amen. Doing things I absolutely despise. So if I can't be trusted to figure out what is best for myself and then do it, it becomes obvious that the command is necessary. I'll clean all of this up when we're done. But I need something more, exclamation mark. For if I know the law but can't keep it, and if the power of sin within me keeps sabotaging my best intentions, I obviously need help, exclamation mark. I realize that I don't have what it takes. I can will it, but I can't do it. I decide to do good, but I don't really do it. I decide not to do bad, but then I do that anyway. My decisions, such as they are, don't result in actions. Something has gone wrong deep within me and gets the better of me every time. Has anybody ever had this experience? This is crazy. It happens so regularly that it's predictable. The moment I decide to do good, sin is there to trip me up. I truly delight in God's commands, but it's pretty obvious that not all of me joins in the delight. Parts of me covertly rebel, and just when I least expect it, they take charge. Now, it almost sounds like an excuse for sin. You still with me? Everybody still good? It almost sounds like an excuse for sin. I've heard so many people go to Romans, and they quote these passages, and they use it to justify sinful behavior. But you got to keep reading, because God doesn't leave us there. Paul says, I've tried everything, and nothing helps. I'm at the end of my rope. Is there no one who can do anything for me? Isn't that the real question? The answer, thank God, is that Jesus Christ can and does. He acted to set things right in this life of contradictions, where I want to serve good God with all my heart and mind, but I'm pulled by the influence of sin and do something totally different. So, do you know what sets you free from gravity? Distance. The farther you are away from it, the less the effect it has on you. We have to be so far away that we're no longer affected by its power. So Jesus came not only to pay the penalty for our sins, but he also came to break and set us free from the power of sin. You get that? Amen. Now, let's go to the next slide. Here you are with your family in your elevator car. Now, if you'll notice, there's a counterweight on the left here. And that counterweight, well, let's do this. Let's push the button. We're in the elevator, the door shut, you push the button, and you are magically, effortlessly taken to the seventh floor. Now let's look at what happened in your world when you were in that elevator car. The counterweight. A counterweight has to weigh more than the occupants in the elevator, more than the luggage, more than the elevator car in order to work properly. So when you push the button in the elevator, it sends a signal to the motor and it says, release the counterweight, and up you go. Now, there's a gospel message in here. Under the old covenant, when they would refer to the glory of God, they used the Hebrew word kavod. And kavod means weight. God's presence is so weighty, so heavy. That's really the only way they knew how to describe the glory of God is this heavy thing. And here's the thing. The Bible says that the glory of God is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. So here's what happened. God, when he sent down Jesus, he sent down a counterweight that weighed more than your sin, more than your regrets, more than your addictions, more than your whatever. When God sent Jesus down, he raised you up. That's where the amen goes right there. You guys can clap on that because that's a good thing. That is a good thing. Jesus not only raised you through his resurrection, he lightened your load. He took your sin, your punishment, your shame, your guilt, your failures, all of it, he took on the cross. So when he came down, God raised you up. Romans 7:4 says, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms. God has put distance between you and your sins. You were in one kingdom, and God literally took you and put you in another kingdom. He has removed your sins. How far? Make sure everyone's still up with me. You guys good? How far? East is from the west. He has put distance between you and your sins. So he freed you from the law, and now you serve in a new way in the power of the Spirit. We don't have to go through and read the 630 prohibitions. We are serving in a new way. To continue with the message in Romans, it says, with the arrival of Jesus the Messiah, that faithful dilemma is solved. Those who enter in Christ being here for us no longer have to live under a continuous low-lying black cloud. A new power is in operation. God sent the Spirit of his Son to live in you to give you the power over your flesh. I love that. When I finally got a hold of that thing, my life changed. I used to be bound by addictions and drugs, and I didn't know at the time. I thought, hey, I'm forgiven of sins, and I thought that was the end of the story. I didn't know that I had actually the power over my addictions. And the devil would love to let us think that that's the end of the story, but it's not. You used to gravitate towards the desires of your flesh, but now with the Spirit who is in you, he is bigger, he is greater, he is more powerful than those things that pull at you, and now you gravitate towards the things of God and what he desires. The Bible says, you, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of God, they do not belong to Christ. So, here's the thing. In the realm of the flesh, you have to pay the bill. It comes at your expense, right? After you've spent yourself on your pleasures and passions and pursuing the things of this world, then it's tax time. And the devil says, there's a toll at the end of this road and you need to pay. Gravity begins to take its toll. Not so with the Spirit. The Holy Spirit provides. He provides the power. He does not take. He gives. He liberates. He heals. He provides. He protects. He instructs. He provides you with everything you need for the journey. Now, listen to what Paul said as we bring this thing down. Paul said, for if by the trespass of one the many died, much more. Everybody say much more. We need a boost right here. We need a boost. Much more did the grace of God and the gift of the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, abound to the many. What Paul is saying here is that even though we are spiritually dead as a result of Adam's sin and sentenced to a life of condemnation, the gift of grace we receive in Christ is greater than the condemnation we inherited. Paul said, much more did the grace abound. We could put it this way. We've gained more from the resurrection of Jesus than we lost to the sin of Adam. In fact, the Bible says where sin abound, grace did much more abound. In other words, God has put more grace in you than you ever had sin in you. It's an overpayment. That's a huge amen right there. I'm like, man, I mean, I don't have to go very far back to think, oh, thank God, right? An overpayment, it's more. There's more grace in your life than there ever was sin. That's power right there. That means we can just come. We don't have to have it all together. God has it all together for us. Not only is his grace more than enough, Paul also says we will reign in life. Now, the Greek word for reign is basileo. It means to rule as a king. And I love this next part. With the implication of complete authority and right to control without any restrictions. You have more authority now in Christ than Adam did in the beginning before he sinned in the garden. Jesus said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth, and you're in him. Something the Lord had been saying to me is, everything I am, you are before the Father. Everything I am, you are before the Father. His right standing with God is my right standing with God. And it's scriptural because the Bible says, in this, love has been made perfect among us, that we have boldness in the day of judgment. Because as he is, even so we are in this world. Isn't that great? The band, you can start coming up. We are like him in this world. If we could just get our minds around who we are in Christ, it would be a serious game changer. Listen, you will reign over your flesh and your sin, over the world and its ways, over the devil, over the powers of darkness. You will reign in your home and over whatever atmosphere you're in. You will reign in your calling. You will reign in the body of believers. You will reign in every area of life. And ultimately, in the end, we will reign with him in the eternal kingdom. You guys can say amen right there. Amen. And this is when it hit me, that this is not just a message on how the world and the flesh and the devil pull at us. This is a message of how the gravity of grace is stronger and greater than the attraction of the world. Because grace is so much bigger than anything in the world. Grace outweighs and outsizes the gravity of the world. And that God is in you, and that God is for you. Amen. Did you get it? All right. They're going to close us out, so we always leave the altar open if you want to come up, if you need prayer, or whatever it is you need. This awesome God that we serve is always here and ready to meet you wherever you are. Amen? All right.
Saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. God, my Savior, has ransomed me. Like a flood, His mercy reigns. Ending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior. Ransom me. Like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace.
Bringing that, but thank you, God, more for the word. If you've ever had chains on in your life, I mean literally ever had chains on, you get them free. It is a true release, isn't it? And if you think about what sin does in your life, I love the fact that, man, God's put more grace in us ever than He did sin. Well, He didn't put sin in us, right? We chose it. I mean, I'm like completely undoing the whole sermon. But anyway, I love that. What a great message. Hey, we're glad that you were here today. Really, really glad. And welcome. If you don't have a church, we'd love to have you here, whether that's online or here in person. And we have a lot of stuff that goes on throughout the week. We have Bible studies. If you want to get in one, come see me. We'd love to help you get set up in one. We have a prayer meeting here every Wednesday night. Our youth groups meets on Sunday night. Tonight, like Drew said, at 5:30. So we'd love to have you. And again, we're glad that you're here. Keep praying for Sam and Doug and Edward. Actually, I think Doug is on his way back. Is that right? Yep, he's on his way back, I think, as of today. So he'll be back, I think, tomorrow. But Sam and Edward still have a long journey ahead of them. They've been to multiple countries, and they're experiencing a lot of, I guess you say success. It's weird to say that, but because God is providing and unbelievable things that are happening. And the same thing can happen right here, right? And that's what our challenge is. And really, the challenge now is it's pretty easy when you have grace, right? So pray with me, and then we'll let you go. God, thank you for a great, great day. God, thank you for the sunshine coming in that just lights up our spirit. It fills our heart, God. And thank you for this grace that, God, we know about, we read about, and we understand, I guess, sometimes. But, God, as you spoke through Jerry today and just kind of shared the gravity of this grace, it is bigger and stronger and weightier than anything else. And, God, no matter what, you are in charge, and you have taken us, God, and freed us from our chains, and we thank you for that. God, I pray for Doug's travel home today. I pray, God, that you would be with him and refresh him as he comes back home. God, I pray that you be with Edward and Sam as they move forward and continue on their journey. God, I pray that you would give them courage and you would give them peace. And God, you give them the words. They're encountering things that are not normal, and a lot of friction and a lot of things that will stand in the way, God. But it's the same Satan, the same devil that wants to block us here. It just looks a little different, God. And I pray that we would have our eyes open and see when evil and when Satan is trying to, God, just to get us off track in whatever way it may be. And maybe it may come in a form of comfort here, or it may come in a form, God, that seems good. But God, help us to be awake and always on the move for you. God, I want to continue to pray for everything going on in our world, and that you would be with the conflicts in Ukraine and Russia. And God, there are other places, I'm sure, too, that things are going on. And God, there are Christians that are being challenged and really just put through a lot, and non-Christians, God, that need to know your word. And God, help us to take this grace and share it with everybody that we can, and to be motivated as we walk out of here today. God, I pray for those that came forward, that you would be with them. God, that you would give them encouragement, that you would give them your peace, and that you would lay your hand on them. God, thank you for everybody here, everybody online today. And God, I ask for this week to just be about you, that you would help us to remember who you are and that grace that you gave us. Father, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a great day.